Hello students, in geography in the earlier chapters we have studied about different resources of India. These resources or natural resources are free gift of nature to the mankind. We have studied about soil as a natural resource, forest as a natural resource. And these natural resources are very essential for the existence of human beings. They are not only essential for existence of human beings, the natural resources are also wealth of a nation. Soil is a natural resource, forest is also a natural resource, and so is water. Water is also a very important natural resource, and the availability of water resources is very essential for the existence of human beings. And these natural resources are not only essential for existence of human beings, they are also very essential for the economic development of the country. The economic development depends upon the natural resources. Water. Water is also an important natural resource, and you can call water as the wealth of the nation. So, in today's chapter, Geography Unit 6, we will be reading about water resources of India. In this chapter, we are going to learn about the importance of water resources, major rivers of India, irrigation, meaning and its need, types of irrigation and their distribution, and multi-purpose river valley projects. Importance of water. Water is one of the most precious natural resources. Without water, it is impossible to sustain life. Human beings need it for drinking, cooking, washing, agriculture, generation of hydroelectricity, industries, navigation, fishing, etc. India is endowed with substantial water resources. India has many rivers and gets sufficient rainfall and has extensive surface water resources. India also has vast reserves of groundwater. Water resource can be divided into surface water and groundwater resources. The surface water resources are rainfall, rivers, lakes, tanks, and springs. India has extensive surface water resources. Major rivers of India. India has many river systems. They are the natural resources of the country. The rivers are useful for irrigation providing water for agriculture, generation of hydropower, generation of hydroelectricity, inland waterways. They also help in traveling from one place to another, fishing, etc. The river systems of India can be divided into two groups: rivers of North India and rivers of Peninsular India. Rivers of North India. They are also known as the Himalayan rivers. The important rivers are the Indus, the Ganges, and the Brahmaputra. The river Indus or Sindhu, also called, rises near Mount Kailash in Tibet. Initially, it flows northwestwards, then it flows towards the southwest and enters Pakistan. Finally, it joins the Arabian Sea near Karachi. The total length of the river Indus is 2897 kilometers, out of which 709 kilometers lies in India. But the major part of its course is in Pakistan. River Indus receives many tributaries. The main tributaries of River Indus are Jhelum, Chenab, Bias, Rabi, and Satluj. This is River Indus. Major part of River Indus flowing through Pakistan and joining Arabian Sea near Karachi. And the important tributaries of River Indus are Jhelum, Chenab, Bias, Rabi, and Satluj. The Ganga. The Ganga River is the largest river of India. River Ganga has a total length of 2,525 kilometers. The river Ganga rises, it takes birth in the Gangotri Glacier. The birthplace of river Ganga is Gangotri Glacier. It flows towards the south and then southeast, then enters Bangladesh, where it joins the river Brahmaputra. After it joins Brahmaputra, it continues to flow as River Padma. And finally, River Ganga flows into the Bay of Bengal. River Ganga also has some important tributaries. The major tributaries of River Ganga are Yamuna, Ghagra, Gandak, Ramaganga, Gomati, Sarada, Son, and Kosi. Among its tributaries, Yamuna is the longest tributary. Which is the longest tributary of River Ganga? Yamuna. You can see River Ganga and its tributaries. It rises at Gangotri Glacier, and River Ganga has many tributaries, among them Yamuna, Ghagra, Gandak, Ramaganga, Gomati, Sarada, Son, and Kosi, and Yamuna is the longest tributary. The third important river systems of India is Brahmaputra. The river Brahmaputra rises near Lake Manasa Sarovar in Tibet and flows towards the east. It enters India through a narrow gorge in Arunachal Pradesh. Then it flows to the west and turns to the south in Bangladesh, where River Brahmaputra joins River Ganga. Its total length is 2,589 kilometers. You can see the River Brahmaputra. Rivers of South India. Many rivers flow across South India. The South Indian rivers are also known as peninsular rivers. Most of them rises in the Western Ghats. The important rivers of South India are Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, Narmada, Tapi, and their tributaries. The rivers of South India can be grouped into east flowing and west flowing rivers. Some rivers flow towards the east, whereas some others flow towards the west. So they can be grouped as east flowing rivers and west flowing rivers. East flowing rivers. The Mahanadi rises in Siwaha range and it flows towards the east and joins the Bay of Bengal. The Godavari. The Godavari is the longest river in South India. Which is the longest river in South India? Godavari. River Godavari rises in Triambaka and flows towards the east, 1465 kilometers, and joins the Bay of Bengal. River Krishna. River Krishna rises near Mahabaleshwara. Then it flows towards the southeast and joins the Bay of Bengal. The main tributaries of River Krishna are Bhima, Tungabhadra, Koyna, Ghataprabha and Malaprabha. River Kaveri. River Kaveri rises at Talakaveri in Kodagu district in Karnataka. It flows towards the east and joins the Bay of Bengal. River Kaveri also has many tributaries. The important tributaries of River Kaveri are Hemavati, Shimsha, Kapila, Arkavati, Lakshmana Tirtha, Suvarnavati and Bhavani. These are the main tributaries of River Kaveri. Now let us come to the west flowing rivers. Narmada and Tapi. Narmada and Tapati, it is also called Tapati, so are the important west flowing rivers of South India. River Narmada rises in Amarkantak. River Narmada rises in Amarkantak Hills and flows westward 1312 kilometers through a narrow gorge called Marble Gorge. And finally, River Narmada joins the Arabian Sea. The Tapi. Tapi, it is also called Tapati. It rises near Multai. It flows westwards and finally joins the Arabian Sea. Many other west flowing rivers are short and swift. They are not very lengthy. They are very short and they are swift. They flow very swiftly, very quickly. There are, other than Narmada and Tapati, there are some more west flowing rivers. The important among them are Sabarmati, Mandovi, Zuwari, Bidti, Sharavati, Kali, Netravati and Periyar. These are some other important west flowing rivers of South India. Now students, to remember the rivers, their sources and very important facts related to examination, we can make a chart like this. We can make a table like this so that the important facts about the rivers can be learned very easily. Rivers of North India, they are also called Himalayan rivers. The important North Indian rivers are Indus, Ganga and Brahmaputra. River Indus, also called Sindhu, takes birth, rises in Mount Kailash in Tibet. The important tributaries of River Indus are Jhelum, Chenab, Bias, Ravi and Satluj. The River Ganga. River Ganga raises in Gangotri Glacier. River Ganga has many tributaries. The important tributaries are Yamuna, Ghagra, Gandak, Ramaganga, Gomti, Sarada, Son and Kosi. River Ganga is the largest river of India. After it enters Bangladesh, it is called by the name Padma. After joining Brahmaputra in Bangladesh. And among the tributaries, Yamuna is the longest tributary. River Brahmaputra. River Brahmaputra rises near Lake Manasa Sarovar in Tibet. River Brahmaputra joins Ganga in Bangladesh and finally join the Bay of Bengal. Now let us come to rivers of South India. Rivers of South India are also called peninsular rivers. And rivers of South India are grouped into two categories, east flowing rivers and west flowing rivers. The important east flowing rivers are Mahanadi. River Mahanadi rises at Siwaha Range and River Mahanadi is called the Sorrow of Orissa. River Godavari. River Godavari rises at Tharyambaka and Godavari is the longest river in South India. River Krishna. River Krishna rises at Mahabaleshwara. River Krishna has many tributaries. The important tributaries are Bhima, Tungabhadra, Koina, Ghataprabha and Malaprabha. River Kaveri. River Kaveri raises at Talakaveri in Kodagu district in Karnataka. River Kaveri also has many tributaries. The important tributaries are Hemavati, Shimsha, Kapila, Arkavati, Lakshmana Tirtha, Suvarnavati and Bhavani. West flowing rivers of South India. The two important west flowing rivers of South India are Narmada and Tapi, also called Tapati. River Narmada rises in Amarkantak Hills and it flows through a gorge called Marble Gorge. River Tapati or Tapi rises at Multai. There are other important west flowing rivers in South India. The other important west flowing rivers of South India are Sabarmati, Mandovi, Zuwari, Bidti, Sharavati, Kali, Netravati and Periyar. So, with the help of this chart, we can remember the most important aspects of Indian rivers from examination point of view. Irrigation. What is irrigation? Meaning of irrigation. The artificial supply of water for the purpose of agriculture is called irrigation. Irrigation refers to the supply of water to agricultural land from rivers, reservoirs, tanks or from underground resources. So, irrigation is the artificial, man-made arrangement of supplying water for the purpose of agriculture. What is the need of irrigation in India? Why we need irrigation in India? India is an agricultural country. Therefore, it needs a regular and sufficient supply of water. Agriculture in India depends mainly on monsoon rainfall. And monsoon rainfall in India is seasonal, uncertain and unevenly distributed. There are certain crops which require larger and regular supply of water, such as rice, sugarcane, etc. Besides, to increase the yield and production of crops required regular supply of water. This can be provided only by irrigation, which is very essential in India. Types of irrigations. The important types of irrigation in India are wells, canals, and tanks. Recently, other types of irrigations such as sprinkler and drip irrigation have been introduced. Now let us take up well irrigation. Well irrigation is the most important type of irrigation practiced in India. Nearly 60.7% of the total irrigated area is from well irrigation. So among the three types of irrigation practiced in India, well irrigation is the most important and widely practiced type of irrigation. Well irrigation is possible even in areas of low rainfall. Well irrigation is cheap when compared to other methods of irrigation, and it is easy to dig wells, and to dig wells they do not require superior technology. It is easy even for small farmers to dig wells. So even for small farmers, digging wells do not require large sums of money. So these are some of the advantages of well irrigation. Well irrigation is largely practiced in Ganga plains, including Punjab, Haryana, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and West Bengal. In South India, well irrigation is widely practiced in Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka. Wells are of two types, namely open wells and tube wells. You can see open wells, water can be seen on the surface. Tube wells, you cannot see the water, they have deep access of water. Tube well irrigation has become widespread in India these days. So there are two types of wells, open wells and tube wells. Tube wells are also called bore wells. The second type of irrigation practiced in India is the canal irrigation. Canal irrigation occupies the second place after well irrigation, and canal irrigation accounts for about 27% of the total irrigated area in India. India has one of the world's largest canal systems. The government is responsible for the construction and maintenance of canals. There are two types of canals, inundation canals and perennial canals. Inundation means flood. Perennial means throughout the year. In inundation canals, water is drawn directly from the river without building any dam. So, in case of inundation canals, water is taken directly from the river without constructing, without building any dam. So, whenever there is heavy rainfall, whenever there is excess flood water in the river, that excess flood water is diverted through these canals. So, the flood water is taken through these canals and no dam is built. In the case of perennial canals, dams are constructed across the rivers and water is stored in the reservoirs and used for agriculture through canals. So, in the case of inundation canals, the water is directly taken from the river without building a dam. In case of perennial canals, dams are constructed across the rivers and water which is stored behind the dam in the reservoirs and is passed through the canal and used for agriculture through canals. So there are two types of canals. You can see inundation canals, water is directly drawn from the river without building any dam. In the case of perennial canals, dams are constructed across the rivers and water gets stored behind the dam. And the water which is stored behind the dam is called reservoir. And canals are taken from the reservoir and supplied to agricultural lands. Canal irrigation is extensive. It is widely practiced in Uttar Pradesh, Punjab, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Haryana, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, Orissa, West Bengal and Karnataka states. And India has the largest area under irrigation in the world and China ranks second. So this is additional information. India has the largest area under irrigation in the world and next to China. The third important type of irrigation practiced in India is tank irrigation. What is a tank? A tank is a natural or man-made reservoir on the earth's surface in which rainwater is collected. This water is used for irrigation. Most of the tanks are non-perennial. It means the tanks won't be supplying water to agriculture throughout the year. So only whenever there is sufficient water in the tank, the water is supplied through small canals, and when there is no water in the tank, and canals also dry up. So they are not perennial. The tank water is not supplied to agriculture throughout the year. It is supplied only when there is water in the tanks. In recent years, the area under tank irrigation has been decreasing. Now only 3% of the total irrigated area is under tank irrigation. Tank irrigation is mainly found in Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Orissa, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh. Tank irrigation. This is a tank. Whenever there is rainfall, the tanks get filled and this water can be passed to nearby agricultural lands through small canals. When there is water gets exhausted, there is no water in the tank, there is no water in the canals also. Therefore, tank irrigation is non-perennial. They cannot supply water to agricultural lands throughout the year. So, that is all for today. We will continue this lesson in the next class and let us take a look at today's assignment number 112. Very simple questions. What is the importance of water? Which is the largest river of India? Name the important east flowing rivers of peninsular India. What is meant by irrigation? Which are the three types of irrigation practiced in India? Children, practice these questions and learn them. And we will continue this lesson in the next class. Till we meet again in the next class, take care of yourself. Have a good day. Thank you.